Wow. Well, I've got to say, it's really such a treat to have the two of you here. This film, I think, I'm continued to be amazed by it. I've seen it quite a number of times, and I didn't watch the entire screening today, but just walking in towards the final moments, I'm still struck by the fact that emotionally, it seems every note in terms of the acting, the writing, the directing, the story, just rings true and has an integrity and an honesty and a power that you can feel in the air. And I just want to congratulate you on this incredible accomplishment.
Thank you.
Interestingly, I think the thing, we'd like to focus a lot, certainly the themes and the message and the meaning of the film is inextricably woven into it, and those issues are going to come up. But for today's talk, we wanted to highlight the filmmaking process a little bit. And there's clearly, Sister Helen, your book is the source. I mean, and you opening your book, there's a quote that you open your book with, or not a quote, but maybe you're quoting somebody's, about there's two kinds of stories in this world. Mm-hmm. And can you just share us what is
well,
that?
Well, the two kinds of stories generally are about extraordinary people that get thrown into ordinary circumstances, like a prince or princess who suddenly is just thrown into a village with ordinary peasants, and they don't know it's a prince or the princess. And the other is where an ordinary person gets catapulted into extraordinary circumstances, which is more, you know, my story.
Yeah, definitely. And I guess the thing about turning this incredible book, which if you have not read the book, read the book. It's an extraordinary piece of nonfiction. And it's the basis for the film. But what's interesting, what I'd love to hear more about, and I think the audience would be really interested to hear, is how did Helen's work come into your life, Tim? And how did you first encounter it? And what made you decide to turn this into a film? And what were some of your first instincts or images or inspirations for wanting to go on that long journey to bring it to the screen?
Well, I was working on a screenplay at the time that my partner at the time, Susan Sarandon, she said, "I want you to read this book." I met with this nun down in New Orleans when I was down there, and I think it'd make a great film. And I was doing research on Cradle Will Rock, and I was stuck in my like fourth draft of that, and I just was obsessed with that. And so it took me a while to read the book. And finally, there was this altercation on Sixth Avenue in New York. And it was, you know, are you going to read this or should I move on? And I said, all right, I'll read it. And I read it and immediately was struck about what a great movie it could be. And started at that point, that was the summer. And then by September, I had highlighted and what I felt was the essential story in the book, and started putting it down on paper. And it was the main thing was to come. There were two stories. There was two death row inmates that Sister Helen meets
in the book.
And I felt it could only be one. And I also felt because the memory was so fresh with a lot of the people that were involved in these murders, that it was important for us to change the names and a certain amount of the circumstances, but to remain true to the characters in the book. And so I wrote the first draft in September, and it was the fastest I'd ever this has ever happened before or since. But I wrote the first draft in September, and we were shooting by February. So I did a couple drafts in between, but mm-hmm. The main thing that I wanted to address with Sister Helen is that I didn't want to do there was one man in the book whose guilt was questionable, and I didn't want to tell that story. I wanted to tell the story of the guy that was clearly guilty, who was a despicable human being. I wanted to make it difficult for the audience, because ultimately I don't think anyone will argue that we shouldn't kill that we should kill innocent people. I wanted the argument to be more complex than that. Can we kill even the most despicable human beings. And Sister Helen agreed with that, and she would send me notes on the various drafts. It was the first time I'd gotten grammatical notes from a nun since grade school, and so it stirred up some awful memories for me. And
come on now, you've been restored, you've been rehabilitated with nuns. I know you had some mean ones.
I had some tough ones.
We're having counseling going on right here in front of you.
Right. Yes.
Restorative justice.
Still recovering. Still. Hi, I'm Tim, and I'm a recovering Catholic. but what I really loved about Sister Helen was that she got it. She got that we had to make it difficult for ourselves. Mm-hmm. That if we're really going to make the proper kind of film, we have to be very difficult with ourselves.
Had you previously wanted to make an anti-death penalty film? Had that been something that had been in your thoughts, or was it more in response to this material?
Not really. And I had young children at the time, and I had, I like any parent, have mixed feelings about what would happen, what would I do if anyone should ever harm a child of mine. Mm-hmm. And I've been in situations that were slightly threatening where just instincts take over, and as a parent you become a bear, you become vicious, to protect your children. So I knew that there was something inherent in everybody that saw retribution for a murder as something that is justifiable. And so I had, although I was against the death penalty, I also felt that I would not fault a parent that walked into a courtroom after the verdict of guilty and took that man's life. I could understand that. Mm-hmm. What I couldn't understand was how the state was applying it and the way they were doing it. And how arbitrary and the kinds of people they chose to kill, and also that they were asking an employee of the state to carry out an act of murder. I felt that was not acceptable as a thinking, reasoning culture to ask someone to kill is, I believe, immoral.
What were there any other major changes that were made from moving from the book? You mentioned that you kind of combined the two death row inmates from the book into one amalgamated Matthew Poncelet. Were there other changes from Helen's writings that you had to cut or combine or lose or fictionalize? And how, what was that process like between the two of you? Did you work together on the script, or did you kind of have story meetings, or how did it work?
Well, in the book, I believe the executions were electrocutions.
Mm-hmm. Right. And
I remember the call I got from you.
What was that?
Well, I don't know how long we were into writing it, and you called and said, "Now, Helen, I know that your people were executed by electrocution, and believe me, as a filmmaker, I hate to lose that image, but I think we have to change it to lethal injection." Mm-hmm. And because everybody's turning to lethal injection as a humane way. And we don't want to give people any moral outs in this film.
That's right.
So we have to ask the question, is there a humane way to kill a conscious, imaginative human being?
And I didn't want people to get to the end of the journey and say have people say, okay, you're right, we shouldn't electrocute people. because that would be would have been a very graphic and disturbing ending. But I felt the even more disturbing ending was the clinicalization of it.
Right, which is just what it's become.
Hmm. Yeah.
I mean, they even put alcohol on a person's arm before they lethally inject them and kill them.
Mm-hmm. So moving on in the filmmaking process then, what were the next steps once you had the script ready to go in terms of getting financing and backing and support? I mean, what were the first choices or decisions you made that started to define the project?
Well, I had my sister Helen,
Well, before we go, skip that, so, I mean, did Susan want it, was that what she was saying when she said, read the book, I want to place Sister Helen Prejean?
Yeah.
Okay, so that was part of
Didn't
it.
Didn't you say she needed work? Well, she said that. No, she knew she wanted to do that.
No, she knew she wanted to do the part. And I thought she was perfect for it, you know, and she was incredible in it. Yeah. The question was, who is going to play Matthew Ponsley? Mm-hmm. And Sean Penn had just given an interview where he had retired from acting. And I had known him a little bit. He'd been an acquaintance. And I said, well, it's worth a shot. And so I sent him the script. And because I, you know what I felt when I read that article? I felt, well, I've felt that way too. Because the scripts you get are such crap, you know? Mm-hmm. And at some point you just, it's this malaise comes over you and you go, what's the point? You know? And you feel like retiring, you know? And so I, on a hunch, I figured, well, maybe that's what he was talking about. And so I sent him the script, went out to LA and met with him. And he said, I'm in. And to his credit, he was all the way in. There was a little, as you'll find all those that are film students, there's shenanigans that go on with film financing. And there was a bit of shenanigans going on at the last minute when we were going full bore into production. A reduction of the budget, shall we say. And it meant that they were essentially under the belief that we would all work for a lot less than we had been promised. And they were right with Susan and I, but they didn't know that about Sean. And so Sean, to his credit, said, I don't care. I want to do this film.
Wow. Yeah. Uh-huh. Wow.
And Tim, did I remember this right, that when he read the screenplay, that he found himself crying? Mm. That when you find your tears dropping on the page, you know it's something you gotta do?
Yeah. Mm. Yeah.
Yeah. Mm.
Wow. And what about the shoot itself? You shot a lot of it on location in Louisiana?
Yes.
And then some on sets built in New York, is that right?
Yeah, right across the street from my apartment.
Actually. Oh, really?
Yeah.
That's convenient.
It was very convenient.
All the interior scenes, when I walked in there, I couldn't believe it. It was just like the death row cells in Louisiana. I couldn't believe they had done that.
Right.
And they don't use real pipe on the cell bars. You know, you use that plastic stuff. But when you have to clang the door, you use real steel.
Mm. Yeah.
These are things I picked up.
Yeah, that's right.
You remember how hot that place was?
Whoa, is it hot.
Oh, my God.
And remember, they didn't have
the... recreated Louisiana.
Oh, man. But, Tim, remember when we were doing it and you said, now this is going to be about Louisiana, but there will be no fat-bellied sheriffs. There will be no moss hanging from the trees. All that, you know, cliche stuff about the South.
Mm-hmm. Hate cliches.
But how,
the other thing we wanted to avoid, by the way, was the idea of... Because I talked to my brother, David, who did the score. I said, I really want to avoid the idea of Christian spirituality in the music. Mm-hmm. I wanted to find a spirituality that was more universal.
Yeah.
And that's what led us to Nusrat Fateh Ali Khan. And Rai Kuder and VM Bhatt have done a beautiful album called A Meeting Across the River. And I gave that to my brother and Nusrat's recordings. And we both agreed that this was the direction to go. What we had no idea of at the time was that when we were doing post in New York, right around the time when we were about to be recording the score, Nusrat Fateh Ali Khan was on tour and playing at Town Hall in New York City. Mm. And so we got in touch through Peter Gabriel, and we had no idea whether he was going to do it or not. He knew about it. We went to see his show, which was the most transcendent live event I've ever been to. Mm. And I thought Town Hall had lifted up off the ground. Mm. And then the next day, he was meant to come into the studio. the sound the recording studio, and watch the film because he hadn't seen it, and it could have gone either way. I mean, we didn't know he would like the film, so we had everything set up, and Eddie Vedder was there, and Ry Cooter was there, and we had the musicians ready, and we had we had put some rugs down and some candles and pillows, and had all the mics in a circle so that the guys could see each other. But we had no idea whether Newsrat was going to like it. And then he sits down, and then I realize he doesn't speak English. And so...
so much for that interview.
So I'm sitting there, and Eddie and Rod just, and David, just completely nervous, watching kind of through this glass, soundproof glass, while Newsrat's watching it on a television, and someone's translating it to him the whole time, and wound up loving the film, and wound up being a real great addition to the feeling in the film.
That's great. Yeah, I mean, the soundtrack is really striking, and it's not what you would expect, and I guess that's what you're talking about, is going against kind of the cliche or something. It has this otherworldly, quality to it, and of course, it's just a tremendous, incredible soundtrack of original songs, and then you mentioned your brother did the score.
Mm-hmm.
Is that, do you work with your brother, and is it on film scores?
Yeah, he did the score and wrote the music for Bob Roberts, and wrote the score for Cradle Will Rock as well.
That's great.
Yeah.
That's great. There's a few family members.
I remember, too, Tim explained to me about music, that, it's not going to be Mickey Mouse wall-to-wall music in the old-style films, when it's real creepy, you have the creepy music, and then when it's, it matches the mood.
Mm-hmm.
You remember what you said about how you're going to do the music?
Yeah, I also remember saying that silence is music. And it's very important, the silence in the film.
Yeah.
And it's part of the scoring. It's its own music.
Yeah. It's profound.
And I think people tend to think that, and I don't like this in films, when people overcompensate and they try to tell you what emotion you should be feeling, usually with strings.
Yeah.
People are addicted to strings. And I don't like hearing that. You have to trust that the audience can get there.
Yeah.
And sometimes a plucking string is a lot better than a bowed string.
Yeah. That's interesting. No, I agree. I mean, I think, again, that's one of the things that makes the film so powerful, is that it's presenting very clearly, this story and this development of Sister Helen's character, what she's going through, at the same time what Sean Penn's character is going through. But it's not telling you how to feel about it.
No.
It's letting the audience kind of have their own experience. And it's presenting you with a really complex contradiction, that it's not a simple answer in a way, or we're saying, there's a very compelling problem that we have to address, and yet by ignoring the counter argument is not going to help us address it. And you seem to balance that really,
I think,
well.
One of the most effective moments of scoring in that film is the squeaking sneakers.
Oh yeah, I was going to say, yeah.
Which we didn't have at the time, because they had the wrong kind of shoes. We had to put that in later. But
oh, really? So the kid is actually not making any sound on set?
Not the ones you hear.
Wow.
It was because it wasn't right.
Great.
We had to find the right sound of it. And for me, that was the most haunting moment.
Yeah.
I got to tell you a story about squeaky sneakers. There's this talk show host in New Orleans who's just right of Genghis Khan, all for the death penalty, all for guns, all for everything. And so he comes on the radio the next morning for his show after he'd seen Dead Man Walk. He says, "Okay, folks, you can put it down on record. I went to see Dead Man Walking last night. And I'm going to tell you what got to me. It's the kid walking across that waiting room with his brother who's about to be killed with those sneakers squeaking." And I said to myself, "That kid doesn't deserve that. He didn't kill anybody. And I'm finished with the death penalty. You don't even have to call. Wow. I'm done with it." And the squeaky sneakers and that kid is what got to him. And he's a dyed-in-the-wool kind of really right-wing guy. Everybody knew him in New Orleans, and that got him.
Wow, that's something. Yeah, I mean, it's, again, that point is that to me, that's filmmaking. It's like finding the details about life that nobody ever would speak about. It's like that's the memory that would stick in your mind, and yet it's a detail that it's inspired to realize that it comes down to these mundane details, and yet they just take on such tremendous significance in the right circumstances.
It was in the book, wasn't it? So.
Is it in the book? Yeah. Is it in the book? That's right. So it's kind of, again, coming from your writing of your experience, and then it gets
I remember reading that and going, wow.
Because
wow.
You know what? When you're having that last visit with the mother and the brothers with their silences, they don't know what to say to each other.
Yeah.
You know, they talk about all, you know, the cars or the boys talk about stuff and all, and then it's, you're quiet. And that kid walking back and forth across.
Sister Helen, what was it like for you to suddenly find yourself in the world of filmmaking, of movie making?
Well, I mean, I'm not really in the world of filmmaking too much, you know?
Yeah.
But I learned about it. Well, the only filmmaking course I ever got was from Tim making the film, you know, that's it for me. But I can tell you this, the very first day, remember we were doing it in Slidell, victims' families, mm-hmm. Susan goes up to the door, Earl Delacroix. He gave me these little phones, headphones, and I'm leaning over your shoulder looking at the screen. Very first scene, and it was Susan going to the door, and it was with the victim's family. And I think I saw Susan portraying me for a half a second, and then I went right back. Because those scenes with the victim's families and their loss and their pain were just so, it's like a, you know, a cauldron that just sucked me right back in. And I loved, you know, I didn't know much about doing films, but what I was told was, if you ever do sign a contract with anybody to do your film, you make sure you trust the people you're doing it with, because after you sign that contract, they can do anything with your book. They can make it to a musical comedy if they want. And I met Susan, and I knew I trusted Susan. She said Tim should do it, so through her, I came to trust him, and then I met him, and so it's about trust.
Oh, great. Tim, I did want to ask you if you can shed any light on, I mean, the performances are just so subtle and nuanced and complex and powerful, and obviously, oh, thank you. Water in case anybody's, just in case anybody.
Thank you.
But also the supporting cast, I mean, it's a really strong, the so-called minor character is really not minor at all. I mean, what is your, you're the artistic director of a theater company for 30 years, you trained as an actor, you're an extraordinary actor, and on film and on stage. What is, do you have a technique or a way of working with actors to get them to these roles, these moments? And can you shed any light on anything from the making of Dead Man Walking that was maybe an acting challenge or a challenging scene that you had to really help an actor get to a certain place?
It was pretty seamless once we got down there. It's really in the casting.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know, I had a great casting director named Doug Abel in New York City. He introduced me to Roberta Maxwell and Celia Weston, who I think are tremendous actors, who hadn't worked much in film at that point, theater actors.
Mm-hmm.
But I guess what you're looking for is you're looking for a moment of undeniable truth. And you can have any preconceived notions of who you might want to cast, but at the end of the day, you really have to trust that moment of undeniable truth. And that happens in the audition.
Mm-hmm.
And it's something that I've talked to actors about, you know, friends of mine that I couldn't cast in the movie. Because it isn't about who's the most talented actor. It's not about, there's no reflection. If you're an actor and you don't get a part, you should never feel bad about it, because it's something else. It's something that it's kind of indefinable. It's kind of this little magic thing
mm-hmm.
that happens. And when it happens, you go, oh yes, of course, that's the person.
Yeah.
And at that point you say, well, you know, I don't have to see anybody else. That is that moment that works for me.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, there's hurt feelings and stuff, but at the end of the day, you have to be a servant to your film. Mm-hmm. You have to be a servant to the story. It will tell you what it is. Mm-hmm. The actors will tell you whether they're right or not. Mm. And when you're editing, it then the film starts telling you what it is. Mm-hmm. There are a lot of scenes with the character of Hilton Barber that we lost out of the final cut. Mm. Because, you know, it's actually probably some of the first scenes I wrote, which were arguments about the death penalty. Mm-hmm. And and what the film presented itself in the editing room to be was a love story, not an argument about the death penalty. Mm-hmm. And every time we were away from that love story, the film started to lag. So it defined itself. Mm. It told me, you got to cut that. Mm-hmm. So it's terrible to, you know, cut someone's performance. Yeah. Someone that, you know, came and did you a great favor by coming and doing it. But at the end of the day, you have to be loyal to the story. You have to be loyal to the truth.
Yeah. That's great.
At the expense of personal relationships and feelings. And that's... You know,
you heard it.
Time mends all. Yeah. Don't worry.
Right.
I never thought of that.
Yeah. You got to be tough. You got to, you know, you just have to say this is what's right. Yeah.
I just want to mention. So we're going to start to get ready to open up for audience questions. So if you have any questions you'd like to ask Sister Helen or Tim Robbins, if you could please make your way to the audience mics over here on house right or stage left, and in about 5 minutes we'll start to go to audience questions. I wanted to ask another question. I guess as you were moving through post-production and getting ready, I mean, did you have an inkling of what you had in the can? Did you know what this film was going to do, or was it what were the lead up in terms of getting ready for distribution and the release and packaging it and everything? What were your expectations, and what was the reality of the film's initial release and response?
Well, one thing, at the end in the credits, there's a credit says this film was edited on old-fashioned machines.
Yeah, I love that. Steenbeck.
Yeah, well, and a chem.
Chem.
And what was nice about that was that every other Friday in the editing, we'd screen it. So I'd invite people in different stages of the film, and that taught me a lot. You know, it's that moment where you go, I need some feedback. Mm-hmm. I need to, even if the feedback's wrong, you know, it still is important, because it'll tell you something about the film. And so I would have these screenings, and I could tell as it was progressing that it was getting deeper and deeper, and people were getting more and more affected by it. And I think it's around the time when I screened it for Bruce Springsteen that I felt like, oh my God, I think we have something here. Because he came out of the screening, just, you know, he was messed up, and I've always trusted him as an artist, and there was something about him with tears in his eyes that validated the entire process for me. And I remember he said he had driven in from Jersey on his motorcycle, and he said I can't get on it right now. And I remember that was a moment where I was like, well, I think we're onto something here. And then it was interesting, because the process then became a matter of really remaining true to something that was kind of at the base of why I wanted to do the film. And it became a source of debate in the last weeks of editing, which was the revisiting the murder during the execution. And there were a few people that I had trusted, and they had been part of this whole process, that had seen screening at different times in the course of editing, they were adamantly against that. And said that you know, you really shouldn't go back to that. You have the audience. Why are you risking losing the audience at that point? Mm-hmm. And then exactly because it was put that way, I felt that's exactly why it has to be in there. Because I'm not here to win the audience. Mm-hmm. We're not here to win the audience over to a point of view. Mm-hmm. We're here to take them on a journey and to be honest about that journey. And the honest reflection of that moment of execution is that he's being executed with the souls and spirits of those two kids in the room with him. Their parents are there. They have to be there. Mm-hmm. And so we shot, you know, them in reflection. We shot them in... those two actors were on the film for the entire shoot. Mm. Wow. There was a lot we didn't use, but I had them in almost every scene because I didn't know exactly how much we should be seeing them. And, you know, Peter Sarsgaard, he was his first professional job in film. And I was talking to him about it recently. He said, yeah, it was the best job. I got to hang out in New Orleans for 5 weeks. And didn't do anything, but except for one hellish night.
In the mud, getting getting murdered in the mud.
That was horrible. It was a horrible night. Jeez. A horrible night as a filmmaker.
Rained, remember?
It was horrible. It was, and we had to do it over and over again. And it was just one of those moments where you go, I really don't want to be doing this, but we have to, you know.
And the girl would get upset, and we'd have to take a break.
Yeah,
get a
horrible.
Shower. I have some hot tea. I had never thought of all those dimensions that go into people taking those roles, you know.
Yeah, great. Well, let's see, do we have any questions from the audience? Is there anybody?
Hi, my name is Louis Carones. I am a freshman here at DePaul. I'm studying film. And first off, I just want to thank both of you for coming. I've seen this film before, and I just want to say that I'm in love with it. And I have two questions. My first is for Mr. Tim Robbins. So I want to be a director, and someone once told me that directing is all about feeling. And there's a lot of feeling and emotion and expression in this film. And I was just wondering, how did you get your lead actors, such as Susan Sarandon and Sean Penn, to get this emotion, to flood it out to the audience, to get it on the screen? And then my second question is for Sister Helen Prejean. You know, these past few years have been very difficult for our country in regards to mass murders, from the big event in Colorado to the big event in Boston and to the event in Newtown. So if you were a spiritual advisor for these people who committed the attacks, would you approach this differently compared to how you approach the men in your book?
Great questions.
Yeah, good question.
I had, like I said before, a great deal of whether a film works or not is in the casting. And these performances are magic. Sean and Susan, you know, I had to be there and put the camera on and decide where to put the camera. But what they brought was... So committed and so courageous that it was a matter of just standing back and watching. They both got it in a profound way, and they weren't afraid of it. And Sean, you know, to his credit, is a great actor because he's not afraid of being unsympathetic. And a lot of actors of his generation want to be painted in a heroic way or in a way that makes them look good or manly. And Sean is an exception, and that's why his work resonates, is because he has the courage to be ugly and unsympathetic. And the same with Susan. You know, it was... she had a great investment in this and in telling this story. And, you know, Helen made her a little nervous Yeah, a little bit. Huh?
What?
Well, when you're playing a real person, it's, you know, and the person's on the set, you know, it's like a... but she also went there. And so that last scene, the very last scene of them together when he confesses, I felt it was the last scene we did before the execution. We did it all in order. And that was a scene we rehearsed a couple times, and after a couple rehearsals, I just knew they both are so there and so present and so ready to do this that we need to take however long it takes and set two cameras up and figure out how to get these eye lines as close to camera as possible without seeing the other camera. But we're shooting two cameras at once because there was no way I was going to do one side and then come around and do the other side. They were so connected at that point in the process that it was a matter of really making the decision to and asking Roger Deakins, how do we do this? I need to do this seamlessly, and we need to do it quietly and proceed in a way that doesn't get in their way because they're so ready right now. Mm-hmm.
And in response to whether somebody did the Boston Marathon bombing or Tim McVeigh, who killed 168 people in the Oklahoma City bombing, or Willie Celestine that killed an old couple, human beings do unspeakable acts, and I'm outraged over those acts. But when you meet the real person, and you meet a human being, you know you're not meeting a monster. You're meeting a person with a story. You're meeting a person who very often was wounded as a child or abused. 90% of people on death row were abused as children, had violence pumped into them, and one day they pump out violence on other people, which is horrible. So I had to hold in my soul the outrage over the death of these, in the case of Patrick Sonnier and his brother, these innocent kids, and the suffering of that family, and this human being who was being rendered defenseless and stripped of his humanity and walked across the room and killed. And a lot of people ask me, how can you be in the presence of somebody who did that terrible act? And I've come to understand more about the transcendence in the human person. You know, it's easy to kill a monster. So we have Joe Carr now, the younger brother's a monster. Let's let him get well enough so that we can question him. People are saying things like torture him any way you need to get information about why they did that. But if you ever look into the face of a human being and meet them as a human being, it is very difficult to kill them. And one of the things that's making us shut the death penalty down in this country is we're getting more and more stories now of the guards and the executioners and the people who've been doing the killing. And one guy, Jerry Givens, in Newsweek magazine called I Committed Murder, said, I killed 62 people in Virginia. Some of them, I want to tell you, I had an executioner's high because they had killed a child, they had done something really terrible. But he said, I just kept killing people, and I couldn't do it anymore. And he did a public confession to the nation by doing this interview. And so when you get down to it, we're outraged over crime, and often you ask people, do you want to see the death penalty? People go, yeah, yeah, yeah. And it's the whole thing about now going to that place of reflection. Matthew Ponsolet, face on the gurney, is a human being. Who's been through his own journey. And then we kill him, and justice is done. But what does it mean? And what does it mean about us?
Thank you both so much.
Thank you.
Great.
Good luck.
Yeah. All right. We have another question from the audience.
Hi, my name is David Blancleyer. I'm from Uruguay. I'm here because of the Chicago Latino Film Festival. And I have a question for Mr. Tim Robinson. What elements do you have in mind? What is your process when you are doing the shooting plan, the translation from the screenplay to the shooting. I mean, where and why to put the camera to do the film.
Well, the answer to that is to get someone that really knows what they're doing behind the camera. And I hired Roger Deakins for this movie. I had worked on two films with him prior to that, Hudsucker Proxy and then Shawshank Redemption. And I knew I could trust him to make the film look in a certain way. And then what you do is you sit down with your cinematographer and you discuss what that way is. And I think part of being a good, effective director is, and I learned this from Robert Altman, was to let people do their jobs and not think that you have to be an auteur. I think one of the most incredible learning moments for me was watching Bob Altman in pre-production, and someone came up to him and said, Bob, what do we do? You know, I have a question, what do we do about this? And he said, what do you think? And I revered the man, and he was an idol of mine. But what I came to understand was that he put great value in the artistic contribution of everybody on the set. Mm-hmm. And when you create that kind of environment, surprises happen, and great mistakes can turn into great benefits. And so, when I talked to Roger, I talked about the overall feeling of the film, but I trusted that he would get what that meant visually. He would interpret it what my feelings were and my what you call maybe a vision of what I think it should be, and he would then be able to translate that into what lenses to use and what film stock to use and all that. We had one major challenge, though, which was that there were six scenes between Sister Helen and Matthew Poncelet, and they all had the same dynamic. They're sitting down across from each other. And so that was our major challenge. It was, how do we make each one of those distinctly different? And so we started with the idea of the screens and how can we make these screens different? How do we light them differently? If you put the camera here, does the screen disappear? How do you make it reappear? When do you make it reappear? And so then it became about deciding what the emotional mood of each of those scenes was. And that's when you start introducing things like, well, there's a storm during this one, or that this is a bright sunny day. So that we had to really think creatively, because if you think about it, if it had all been static, it could have been really boring, that each time you go back to the same dynamic. So the screen actually really played an important role, and we did lots of tests before we shot with different kinds of screens, different camera angles, how that affected the screen, how the screen caught the light, how to light the screen. So it became like the major screen tests in the film had nothing to do with actors, they had to do with screen.
Screen tests.
Yeah, right. One of you had the glass with the holes in it.
Yeah.
Remember, I asked you about that. Why are you doing that?
Well, as a follow-up to that,
the
also,
reflection
the reflective surfaces, the use of the two images at the same time, because it seems to me that one of the challenges is also, how do you get them in the same shot? Because they're separated for so long. But then that wonderful scene towards the end where you see it's something like the two different realms.
And
really wonderful.
That made that in order to shoot that scene in the plastic, with the plastic between them, that was that meant that we had to light her in the reflection really strongly in order to pick up in order to make it so we could see her.
Mm-hmm.
That was a particularly hot day on the set.
Mm-hmm.
It was one of those moments where, you know, you're like melting your actors and you're like, it looks really great.
That's great.
Thank you.
If I may, I wanted to interject and just bring the focus back to kind of the impact of the film and obviously the issue of capital punishment. Sister Helen, how did this film change your life, and how has the landscape of capital punishment in America changed since the release of this film?
How it changed my life. I knew after I came out of the execution chamber I had to get the story out. I'd been a witness. I knew it was a secret ritual and people would never get close to it. That's why I wrote the book. So when the film happened, I knew it was going to really get the story out. The night of the Academy Awards, there were 1.3 billion people watching.
Wow.
It was the Feast of the Annunciation, those of you who follow the Catholic feast days. And it gave the film over to the world. It changed my life immediately because then everybody knew about the book. Everybody was buying the book. And I was being invited all over to speak. I know my job is to get that story out. So I still follow as a way of how I respond is when I get an invitation, generally, I try to go. Now, sometimes I can't, but I try to. And then I remember, Tim, you remember this? See, all the time when we talk about changing all the names in the film and all, I came to New York with you. We're going down the escalator in LaGuardia in the airport, and I was below you, and I turned around. I said, Tim, what are you going to call the Sister Helen character? You remember that scene?
Mm-hmm.
And Tim goes, well, we're going to call you by your name. You're not going to sue us, are you? And that's when I realized my name was going to be used in the film, and that my name would be out there. So I see it as using it for the work, to get the word out. And I just got to say, I've learned about the American public. People are not deeply wedded to the death penalty. Give them half a chance to get close, reflect, they get it. So the film, I think it changed the way films were done in the United States on the death penalty, myself. If you look at the films that came after, Green Mile, Monsters Ball, what are the other ones? They were much more reflective than before.
But also, I remember a phone call from you. She's saying, it was early on, and you were going on a lecture tour. And you said, Tim, I was in this place that I was at before. She said, last time I was here, there was 25 people. There were 500 people there that night.
Memphis. Was like, wow. It was Memphis. Yeah. We get in the parking lot, and they had to have police with the traffic. And I was there with Margaret Vandiver. I said, is there an Elvis impersonator going on? And it was because people had been to see the movie. They had standing room only in this huge auditorium. Wow. It made such a difference in getting the word out.
Yeah. And so then a couple years into that, she starts bugging me about doing a play adaptation of it.
He needed a new challenge.
One of the reasons we're here in DePaul is because DePaul University is going to be central to that for its future.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And but we've been in the past 7 years. We've been in. Basically I wrote an adaptation, and in order to get the rights, the theater departments of various universities have to convince two other departments in the university to offer courses in the death penalty. And I thought, well, you know, that's never going to happen. But it wound up. We've been in 200 schools across the United States. And it's really what it does is it brings the youth of America to an issue that they might not have thought about, and takes them there in an emotional way so that they have to really delve deep about what their feelings are about this. And we're finding that it's had a profound effect on the way people think about the death penalty. I was also told, I just want to, Sean told me recently, Penn, that he was, that he met with, when he met with Mandela a few years back, and he never told me this for some reason, but he said, when he met with Mandela, Mandela said that when they were forming the Truth and Reconciliation Commission in South Africa, they watched Dead Man Walking, and that it informed their strategy on it. Wow. And I was like, wow, that's really, when you think about how, why you get into this and why you want to tell stories, that was beyond my wildest imagination the time when we were doing it.
And now, making the connection, Archbishop Tutu has written the preface to the reissuing of the book on the 20th anniversary. I see more the connection now, why he was so ready to do that.
Wow. It's tremendous. Another question from the audience?
Oh, hello, thank you for coming to the ball. I have a question for Mr. Robbins. You started out as an actor. I was curious what led you to directing and what are your influences?
Who were my influences?
Yeah.
Yeah. I actually, acting was kind of it wasn't my original intention. I went to college at UCLA to study directing in theater. And I always imagined I would graduate and go back to New York and be a theater director. And I found myself in this competition and wound up getting an agent out of it. And I still didn't think I was going to ever get work as an actor because I was a punk rocker at the time and I just thought it was all bullshit. And then I got a part as a terrorist because I guess they thought my attitude was right. So I kind of fell into it, but when I got my first paycheck, I realized, wow, I can direct any play I want to now. And so I stopped delivering pizzas and started funding a theater company, and I kind of used acting as a way to pursue my directing and pay for it. And it also was an incredible learning ground for me because when you've written a play and you're directing it, to put it into workshop and rehearsal and then see with actors what's wrong with it and then to go home that same night and rewrite was a real great process to go through. And I went through that for a good 4 or 5 years before I even thought about directing a film. And that gave me this kind of discovery about how ephemeral a piece of work has to be in order to evolve. It has to be able to be go in any direction, and the actors will tell you that truth. And so that when I started thinking about directing, I did a short for Saturday Night Live of Bob Roberts, and it felt really right. It felt like, oh, I can do this. And then it took me 5 years to get that first film made. And ultimately, my great luck and good fortune and blessing was to be cast in The Player with Bob Altman directing, right before I directed my first film. And it was like it was my film school. It was my way of really paying close attention to the process. And Bob was such a sweet and loving person. From the very start, involved me, wanted me to play the part because of the theater work I was doing. Not because of, to a certain extent because of my acting, but he more liked me because I was trying to do other things other than act in film. And that's what drew him to me. And so when I met him and talked to him the first time, it was like he was now taking me under his wing. And so that when I showed up on The Player, he sat me down in his office and he said, "We're in this together. We're going to do this together." And he said, "You have to make a pact with me." He said, first of all, I don't like this script. And he says, "We're going to rewrite this script. You and I are going to rewrite this script. But we have to make a pact if we're going to do this. There's going to be producers that are not going to like that. So you have to make a pact with me that if they start messing with me, you'll walk off. And I'll make a pact with you that if they start messing with you, I'll walk off. And it was like this blood pact with Robert Altman.
That's great.
From the very start. So we went and we started in this process. And it was a good like month of sitting down in his office and him investing in me this great trust, valuing me as a writer and a director, which no one had ever done before. And that was my greatest blessing, to be by someone, by the way, when I saw Nashville when I was a teenager, it turned my whole head around about what film could be. It was the first time I saw a film where I said, wow, that's a noble profession. And so to be in the room with him investing that trust in me, was invaluable as an artist. And so when it got around to us figuring out all the different new ways we would do the film and the writer being very pissed off about it, we had this kind of, you know, bond. And it was what really taught me how to direct. And so I took his first AD and I took a cinematographer and we went off and did Bob Roberts.
Thank you.
Great, great, great question. Do you have any other questions?
I got a question, but
can you go to the microphone, please? Just pop them. Go to the microphone. Well, so that way everyone can hear you. Just.
Gotcha.
Thank you. Great film. I'm also here with the Latino Film Festival as well as my compatriots over there. And, you know, making a film, as you know, is our first film, my first film, and theirs as well. You mentioned something earlier about how you would get a lot of scripts and you would get depressed because they were... and that's something we fight. That's something where I'm thinking about for my next film as well, like going commercial or staying artistic. You know, I'm based in New York, so I was just curious what advice you have for filmmakers who want to sort of pursue a more artistic career path like you have.
Keep the rent low.
that's exactly it.
you really have to just ask yourself, why do I want to do this? If you want to do it to become rich and famous, you should probably go commercial. You should probably try to figure out how to work like Michael Bay. You have to, you know. If you really have stories that you're passionate about, that you want to tell, that are important to your heart, and you want to tell them in a pure way, you have to be willing to wait, have patience, and have faith that you'll get it done. It's a lot easier, because of the technology now, to do films for less money. And it's just a matter of how much trappings you want around in order to get a film done. And the good news is that with the good faith and spirit of a few actors and a couple members of a crew, you can make a film. It's just a matter of how much passion you have to tell that story and how much purity you want to retain in it. It's doable. It's not a profession to get particularly wealthy in these days, you know, but it is something like when actors, when young actors ask me, what's your advice about whether I should pursue acting or not? Usually what I say is you shouldn't do it if you're in it for the fame. It's not a good idea because it's very rare. But if by not doing it, it's going to make you miserable, then that's when you should choose it as a profession. Because it's something that's got to be something deeper than simply the surface of it. It's got to be something that's in all of your cells. It's got to be something that you really can't live without. And if that's where you are, then I would say dream on and dream big. You know, a lot is achievable if it's something that you have viewed in your life as an inevitable thing, as something that is unavoidable.
Thank you.
I had a question, actually, I wanted to ask you. This is kind of a devil's advocate question, I guess, or it's about the debate about capital punishment and the story, because it's such a powerful story, Dead Man Walking. But what would you say to the viewpoint that Ponsellet's redemption is forced by the threat of death, and that somehow story-wise...
Berlin.
Yeah. That story-wise, the execution leads to his redemption because of...
And if he hadn't had death hanging over his head,
yeah,
he never would have reached redemption. Yeah. That's the first question Tim was asked at the Berlin Film Festival. First one out of the box. Mr. Robbins, there's kind of theology in your film.
What was my answer?
Oh, it was profound. I've remembered it forever, Tim. And I've repeated it.
What did I say?
Well, the guy had prefaced it by saying, if he had gotten a life sentence, he never would have come to that point. That was the way he let off.
Right.
And that was the first
thing. Oh, I remember what I said.
Okay.
I believe it was. So what you're saying is, so what you're saying is if we torture people into redemption, that that's okay? Is that what I said?
I think you maybe have ended with that, but first you picked him up on, you really don't know, do you, if he had gotten a life sentence, if he would not have reflected on what he had done and come to remorse and redemption.
Right.
And the guy readily admitted, no, you're right, I don't know that.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And then, I think you did use the word torture in there to redemption, but then you asked him, what is it really that led Matthew Ponsellet to acknowledge and take responsibility? Is it because of the threat of death, or because for the first time in his life he met unconditional love?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And the guy went, like, got me. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. All right. Well, that's...
I was impressed.
Yeah. I'm impressed, too. All right.
It's a good thing Sister Hannah has such a great memory.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, he says, come with me to Berlin. We're going to do a few interviews. I did 65 in a day. You did like 145 of all these people coming in for 2 minutes.
I got a story to tell you about that, by the way.
Now?
Can't tell it right now. But I was just at the Berlin Film Festival, and I got a little insight into what happened.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Because now you're on the board.
No, I'm not on the board.
What are you on?
I was on a jury, and I talked to a couple people there.
Okay,
anyway.
All right. You got the inside story.
Can't talk about it.
We did well in Berlin. We won.
Yeah, because all the buzz was about Dead Man Walking, and yet they didn't give us the
golden bear.
The golden bear.
We got the silver bear. Yeah.
Silver bear. All right. And going back again to the sources and your story, Sister Helen, is it true that you were the first woman spiritual advisor to a death row inmates?
In Louisiana. First one. Mm-hmm. To accompany him all the way to death, for sure. I'm not sure if there have never, ever been women, but I think I might have been. And what happened is that the chaplains got really PO'd because I moved into their turf. And they tried to deny all women coming to death row after this. They tried to keep us off death row, so you had to have a head-to-head with the warden that you can't keep women off of. Death row being spiritual advisors. Right. And in the, you know, the movie, the priest doesn't come off too good, you know? Remember you said that? And I said, well, the real ones were worse. Because chaplains can kind of get sucked into the thing of they're like a prison employee.
Mm.
No kidding. They get their paychecks from the prison, and they become compliant and kind of cooperative in helping the one to be executed to go quietly by talking to them about God and where they're going, and they become an agent in the whole process.
Wow. What is the current status of capital punishment and the death penalty in our country, and what still remains to be done? Can you tell us a little bit about your mission, your work, how you're approaching this issue?
We have to take it state by state. If we had a different Supreme Court, they could find it unconstitutional tomorrow morning at 9:00 for the same reason they found it unconstitutional in the Furman decision in 1972. If they ever looked at disparity of practice and see how supposedly the same criteria is 80% of all the executions happened in the 10 states that practice slavery. but they refuse to look at the ground. So we have to do it state by state. And that means educating the people. That means these coalitions of good human beings that work for human rights and educate the public. In the last 6 years, every year another state has put down the death penalty, and we have four more that are poised to put it down. And there are 9 states that haven't had an execution in 5 years. So you have to look at practice, who's actually doing it, how much are they doing it, and even in Texas, it's moved down to like Harris County, which is called the buckle of the death penalty belt in the United States. Used to get 48 death sentences a year, now they get 2. And part of the reason is that jurors who have the person's life in their hands, because if you don't get a unanimous decision, the person doesn't die. So that means if any one of those jurors refuses to give death, the person lives, so they each hold the person's life in their hands. And more of them now know the alternative is that it will be life without parole and that they can keep society safe without imitating the violence, and jurors themselves are making more and more choices for life instead of death. And then the support of the people is not at fever pitch. After the Boston massacre, you're going to hear the call, you know, calls on the radio, yeah, we need to have the death penalty and all. That's going to die down. It goes up and down. But it's like that education of the people, raising consciousness and conscience, because the death penalty is about us. And that's what we keep doing. And I believe we are going to see the end of it. There has been a noticeable shift, started in 2001. And I think Governor George Ryan, whose lawyer is sitting right here, Andrea Lyons, who's done so much for the death penalty movement in this country, he helped inaugurate that, because he was the first governor to say, this thing is broken, and I'm commuting all the sentences on death row in Illinois. So the conversation goes on, and wherever you can get conversation going on, wherever you can get people reading, wherever you get people talking, wherever you get people going to the play or movie, that brings us to the end of the death penalty. Because the more we reflect, the quicker we move to ending it.
That's great. Well put. Tim, anything to add to that?
No, that was well put.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Robbins.
I'm going to rewrite it a little bit later. Then we'll film it.
See what I have to put up with? Remember I asked you, what's a way of writing dialogue in a script? You remember what you answered?
No.
It doesn't sound like dialogue. No speech making.
Yeah.
Real short, just like people talk.
Yep.
It's true. I did want to follow up on one thing that you mentioned the other day when we were having lunch about the Catholic Church and the Vatican, and you mentioned that you have some information, some indication as to whether the film was screened in the Vatican, that it might have had some effect. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
What's Tim is so bold. He said, Helen, we send in a film to the Vatican. I said, all right, go ahead, send it. So it was in there. Now, where it was in the soil of the Vatican, I don't know, but I have a feeling that it did have effect. After the film came out and after the Academy Awards, Archbishop Foley, who was in charge of media in the Vatican, sent me a fax, which I think has faded because we had the old kind of fax machines where the thing fades in front of your eyes. And he said, at last we have a film that shows the real work of American nuns in the United States. And I wanted the whole discourse within the Catholic Church. When I started 1984, Sonier was executed, two-thirds of Catholics believed in the death penalty. And here's what was worse. The more they went to church, the more they believed in the death penalty. Now, that's depressing. But now, two-thirds are against it, and guess who they're led by? The young people. The young people are getting things a lot faster about human rights, gay rights, you know, the death penalty, you name it, young people. And that's why this play project is aimed, because entrusting it to you. I think you're the first playwright who ever did a play and turned it over to the young people of the country to do. Has that ever been done?
I don't know.
That's great. Can you just, a great segue, because in so many ways, it's hitting all media. I mean, there's Sister Helen's writings, her book, the film is extraordinary. And just tell us a little bit about the play project, how that idea was hatched and what the goal and the mission of the play project is.
Well, I mentioned a little earlier, but it's essentially the idea is to go the opposite way and we were thinking about Broadway, and then I thought, well, I don't really want to direct this again. And I I'd gotten such great performances out of everyone, I didn't really want to revisit that mm-hmm. process. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, the idea is that we get it out there as part of a dialogue. And it's really profound what happens with these kids. I mean, I've been to see it in a few different colleges, and there's, you know, there's very strong, healthy debates going on. Mm-hmm. Whereas people don't tend to really talk about this that much. And it's a way to get there in a creative way, in an artistic way, introducing concepts and themes that are important. Because, you know what, if we're going to take lives, we really should be talking about it. And it asks these kids in high school and college to explore the emotions of characters surrounding this story of the death penalty. Mm-hmm. And, you know, sometimes it's a little volatile. There was a little controversy up in Utah last year, and I was happy to see that. Mm-hmm. But because it means people are thinking and feeling and that the play is having an effect. And, it's, mm-hmm. she's been to see more of the shows than
yeah,
I have.
Yeah, and the high schools, see, we've been amazed what the high schools do. We got a letter from a mother whose daughter was in the play in River Valley High School in Texas, right outside of Fort Worth. She writes this letter, very honest letter. She said, "You got to understand, this is Texas. And I heard my daughter's going to be in this play, and I thought, why are they introducing politics into the school here?" And, well, then my daughter comes home, and she's got her role. And so we start talking about it, and she's the mother. She's Lucille, the mother of Matthew Ponsulet, the death row inmate. Mm-hmm. So in our whole family, then we just start reading the book, we just start having these discussions. And the night I went to see my daughter in that role, I moved, 180% within myself. I had never thought about myself as a mother whose child might do something terrible, and how would I feel? And, you know, just from talking with the different students in the high schools and all, sometimes, and it's very honest, because there was one student, she said, "I've always been against the death penalty, you know, because I belong to Amnesty and human rights and all, but I'm one of the victims' families, and the whole victims thing." And then I go, "Wow, but look what they're suffering." So it's really making me think on the other side. Yeah. Had a kid that had an assignment to go see the film A Dead Man Walking, and they had to write essays, and there was a kid wrote this essay. This is from Cincinnati. Said, "Before I went to see that movie Dead Man Walking, I was for the death penalty. After I came out of that movie, I was for the death penalty more. He got what he deserved." And that's the way it affected him. Mm-hmm. That's what art does.
Well, thank you so much, Sister Helen Prejean.
Thank you.
Tim Robbins. This has just been tremendous.